Hey guys, Julie here. Welcome back to Hardware 3D. Today, we're going to be looking at the final component in the window subsystem. That is the mouse input. So we got our first commit here, and we're going to look at mouse.h. And it's basically the same architecture as we had for keyboard, so I'm not going to go over all those ideas again. Just going to cover the differences. So again, we've got a class mouse. It's a friend of window. It has an inner class event. All this is the same. We'll look at the event later on. This part is the same. So basically, for the mouse, we have a queue of events, mouse events, and we have some state variables. The state that we're going to be saving is the X, Y position of the cursor, and the state of the left key and the right key. Notice here, we only have one queue of events, not two, because unlike for the keyboard where you have car input and key down input, here you've only got one type of event. Now let's look at the event class. You've got a bunch of different types for the pressing of the left and the right keys. We've also got events for the mouse wheel and event for just moving the mouse on the screen. You'll notice there's nothing in here for the middle mouse button, but you could implement that yourself quite easily after watching this video. If you can't, then one of us has screwed up. Anyways, so besides the type of the event also stores the state of the left and right buttons at the time the event happened and the position of the cursor at the time the event happened. So you can get that state information screenshot for every event. And again, you know, you've got your constructors, you could check to see if it's a valid, get the type of the event, get the position as a pair here, and also get the individual position X and Y and check the state of the left and the right buttons. And for the main mouse class, I mean, we can get the position of the mouse, again, the X and Y, we get all the state information. And we can read events out of the queue, flush the queue, which is clearing the queue. And on the private side, we have functions here that will register all the different kinds of Windows message events into our mouse component. So again, this should be pretty simple to understand if you've already grasped the keyboard component. Let's look at the CPP here. And you'll see it's pretty much all you would expect. There's nothing in here that is going to be surprising, I don't think. The last thing we're going to look at here before moving on, window.h, we of course add mouse to our components here. And in window.cpp, we're going to add a bunch of stuff for handling mouse messages. So mouse move, button down, button up, and mouse wheel are the events that we handle. The only other thing here is that the mouse wheel message, the L param contains the coordinates. The W param contains some information about the mouse wheel event. So there's a delta. Basically, your mouse wheel can be scroll up or scroll down. And this delta, the value, when you unpack it from the W param, if it's greater than zero, that means it was an up mouse wheel scroll. And if it's less than zero, that means it's a down mouse wheel scroll. Now, it has an actual value, not just positive and negative, and we'll get into that a little bit later. But as a first order approximation, it's usually okay to just check the sign and generate up and down messages based on that sign. Now, whenever you implement a feature, you always got to test that stuff before moving on. And we're going to continue with our modus operandi of setting the window title in order to get feedback. But let's do that in a little sexy way. We are going to add a function, member function setTitle, that will allow us to keep hwind private and encapsulated in our class here. And we do that here. Now, the other thing I do in this commit is I fix a little mistake I had with our good old friend here, adjustWindRect. When we're testing its return value to see if there's an error, I use the macro failed. And this is a failure. So let's see what failed actually does. So we can see the macro expands to basically just a test to see if the result is less than zero. And if it's less than zero, then it is considered failed. Well, let's take a look back at adjustWindRect, shall we? So first off, we notice that the return value is declared as a bool, not as an H result. And that should be a red flag to start off with. The function fails, the return value is zero, but here we're checking for, with fail, we're checking for less than zero. So this is going to miss, it's not going to catch the cases where this failed. So failed is actually meant to work, I believe, with H results. And not all Windows functions return an H result for whatever reason. Some of them just return integers that are not declared as H result, and they don't follow the same rules as H result. So it's just some Windows bullshit. You got to be careful with those return values. So instead of using this convenient failed macro, we've got to just check to see if it's equal to zero. And then we throw the last exception, throw the last error. And we do the same here, I believe. Yeah, we check to see if it's equal to zero. So set window text obeys the same rules as adjust window rect. So do the same check, and we throw last except. So with that junk out of the way, we can test the window input system. And what we're testing, I believe, is we're just checking the event queue here. And we are checking for move events. And when we get them, we change the window title. And you can see here that that is working pretty much as expected. Yeah, don't see any problem with this. Moving on. So we undo that test code, and then here we fix a mistake. So let's see, were you guys sharp enough to catch this? In our message handling code here, for the mouse move message, I forgot to put a break in here, which is going to be a problem because now mouse move will also generate L button down messages every time they happen, and that's not going to be good. Other thing, there's a little consistency, I should make this const as well. Got to get that constipation. I love it. Another problem that I realized and fixed in window.cpp in the constructor here, we're taking in the window's width and height, and we're using that to create the window, but we're not storing it in the class, which is a problem later on when we want to be using that data because it's not initialized. So we've got to actually store it in the class here. Now this next commit here, I implement something called the mouse capture. It's a little bit of a bells and whistles thing here, but let me just demonstrate how that works. All right, so I've got a game running up here. It's called Slay the Spire. And let's see what happens here. So I've got my mouse here. I can click on this card and drag it around the screen. And obviously the game is getting mouse messages and is using that to track the position of the cursor on the screen here. Now, let's see what happens when I drag the cursor off the screen. Now with our current system, in our framework, if you leave the screen, so here I'm dragging to the right, and I'm moving right. In our current system, if you leave the screen, you're not going to get messages for your mouse anymore. Those messages are going to go to a different window. But look here, my cursor is off the screen right now for the game. But if I move up and down, it's still moving the card. If I move left here, keep moving left, and then yeah, and now I'm back onto the screen region. So it is able to receive mouse messages even when the cursor is not over this window. And that's the basic concept of mouse capture. It's especially important when you're doing like dragging operations and you've got a windowed game. Because if you're dragging and you just go off the screen by a little bit, if you don't capture the mouse, that could be interpreted as a release of the drag, and that might drop something down where you don't want it. It's just, it's useful in many situations in a windowed game to be able to capture the mouse. So in order to enable that, we go into mouse.h. We add, well, first off, I add a new concept to the mouse, which is the mouse can be in the window or outside the window. This is independent of capture, but related to it. So I've added events for enter, when the mouse enters the window, the client region, and leave when it leaves the client region. And then we can test to see if the mouse is in the window with this state getter. And we have a couple events here on mouse leave and on mouse enter. And we also have a variable here to store the state of the mouse if it's in the window or not. Now, in mouse.cpp, is in window, that's self-explanatory. And on mouse leave, we will set the in window on mouse leave and mouse enter, and we'll also push the event. So this stuff is pretty straightforward. Now, when we go to windows.cpp, we're going to see a lot of Windows API stuff added in here. And the basic idea is when we handle a mouse move event, we're going to check to see if we are inside of the client region. And if so, we just, you know, log a mouse move event as usual. And if the current state of the mouse component says we're not in the window, then we generate a mouse enter event, tell the mouse component that we have entered the window, And we call a function setCapture, and this will capture the mouse. This is a Windows API function. And what that means is that as long as we have the capture of the mouse, even if the mouse leaves the window region, we're still going to receive mouse move events. So this is if the mouse move happened within the client region. Now, if the mouse move happened outside of the client region, what we do is we check to see if the left button or the right button are currently down. And we can check the state of the left button and the right button by ANDing these masks with WParam, because WParam contains a bunch of information about the event, including the states of the left button and the right button. So we mash these two masks together, and then we mask that against WParam to see if any of those buttons are down. If they are, then we just generate a mouse move, even if we are outside of the region, because that means that we're performing a drag operation. But if the mouse, if the left of the button or the right button aren't down, and we receive a mouse move outside of the client region, then we should release capture of the mouse because we have actually left and we're not dragging. And we also call mouse leave on our component, which will update the state and generate a mouse leave event. And that's it. It's a little bit of tricksy state management, but it's going to give us more flexibility with our mouse. And then we're going to write some test code to test that out. What are we doing here? Mouse leave. So we're logging the mouse leave events and the mouse move events. And let's see what happens. So mouse move works as intended. If we leave the region, the client region, the message turns to gone. So it seems like our mouse leave events are working as intended. Mouse move now. Here I'm going to click, and now I'm going to drag. And you can see here, now I'm getting mouse events outside of the client region. And you'll even see events going into the negative range and beyond the range of the width and the height. And that indicates that the mouse is moving outside of the client region, but we're still getting events for it. So we can still handle dragging and behavior like that when our mouse moves outside the window. But if I release, then it goes back to gone. Then we revert that test code, and here we do the proper wheeled delta. So I told you before that as a quick and easy solution, you can just check the sign of that delta parameter. But if you want to do things the proper way, you're going to have to do a little bit more legwork. So what the mouse wheel message does here is WParam indicates the distance. So the high order word, the top 16 bits, indicate the distance that the wheel is rotated, expressed in multiples or divisions of wheel delta, which is 180. Now, in general, most mouse wheels, what they're going to do is they're going to have discrete clicks. And those clicks, one click is going to equal 120. So your messages, mostly for the most part, are just going to be positive 120 or negative 120. But it gets a little deeper here. Here it says the wheel rotation will be a multiple of wheel delta, which is set at 120. And this is the threshold for action to be taken, such as scrolling or whatever. And here it says the delta was set to 120 to allow Microsoft or other vendors to build finer resolution wheels. So technically, there could exist wheels where the event will have a delta of 60. And that fine resolution wheel means that it actually requires two clicks in order to make up one action. And so for these theoretical wheels, if you process, you generate one event for every click, you're actually going to be generating events twice as fast as you should be. So what you should do if you want to be perfectly accurate is you should check this wheel delta value, and you basically accumulate it up until it reaches positive 120, and then you generate an event. Or if it reaches negative 120, you generate an event. And that'll allow your program to be compatible with these theoretical finer resolution wheels. I haven't encountered them myself, but apparently they could theoretically exist. So you should probably build in support for that. And the other thing it says here is wheel rotation could be a multiple of wheel delta. So you might, in a single message, you might get, for example, 240, which means that you should be generating two events from that single message. So we're going to make our code be able to handle these situations. So in the commit here, proper wheel delta, go into mouse.h. So I've added a member variable here, wheel delta carry, and that's going to accumulate the value received in those messages. And when it reaches some threshold, then we'll generate an event. And okay, so we've got on wheel delta event here that is distinct from wheel up and wheel down, and we'll see how that works in a second. So, mouse.cpp, what we're gonna do here, we have to include windows.h in the CPP file here now because I believe we're using a symbol from it somewhere. I don't know which one. Ah, the wheel delta symbol is the one we wanted. So, what we do is on wheel delta takes the x and the y coordinate of the mouse position, the cursor position at the time the event was received, and the delta value. And all we're going to do is we're going to add to our carry this delta. And then while this carry is greater than 120, which is the threshold, while it's greater than or equal to 120, we subtract the threshold value and we generate a wheel up. So wheel delta generates wheel up or wheel down. And it's possible for it to generate multiple ones if this delta was very large or very small. And this should take care of the logic, at least on the components side. And then in windows.cpp, I think this doesn't change too much. Ah, this actually gets simpler because the logic is moved from this handler into the component, which is nice. So we get the points out of the L param. We get the delta out of the W param, and then we pass that information on to this function here on wheel delta. And this guy will generate wheel up and wheel down events as appropriate. And there you go. That's that handled. And of course, again, always test your shit. So we got the donkey fart box. If I scroll up, up 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, down, negative. All right, so it seems to be working fine. And there you go. There is our mouse component all handled. And this is basically now we have the Windows system all set up like we like. There will of course be future improvements and additions as we go along, but this ends the Windows exclusive arc of our story. In the next video, we are going to handle our final topic before we move into Direct3D proper. That is, we're going to set up a class that represents our application logic. And that class is going to own one or more window objects. We're also going to fix a huge problem with our message pump. But until then, thanks for watching. Hope you enjoyed the video. If you did, please click the like button, it helps a lot. And I will see you soon with some more Hardware 3D.